I know you probably heard about this hundreds of times in your life, but always there's something new to learn. Many people ask me, I daven, I pray every day for years. I don't feel that Hashem ever accepted my prayers. I daven for that kid, I daven for my wife, I daven for my parents, I daven for myself. I daven and the problems continue as usual. Don't you think that at one point I will break and get tired of davening? Anyway, it doesn't get accepted. So why should I even continue? Some people ask like that. Are they lying? Is it possible that they will pray 10, 20 years and really Hashem won't accept their prayers? We have in tradition, Kabbalah, that Hashem is shomea tfilat kol peh. Hashem is listening to the mouth of every person, even the goyim. Shomea tfilat kol peh, not only Jews, everyone. Even the wicked people. We know in the Tanakh or in the Torah that tefillah of wicked people, the prayers of wicked people, made them win against righteous people. I give you an example. Moshe Rabbeinu, everybody understands that Hashem nominated him to be the leader. Hashem nominated Moshe Rabbeinu to be the leader. Korach made a demonstration against Moshe Rabbeinu with 250 other leaders. Moshe Rabbeinu said, tomorrow we will see who Hashem chose. And he was nervous all night, was praying to Hashem all night, crying to Hashem to help him. And right away the question rises, why Moshe had to even be bothered with that? Technically, he should have gone to sleep, relax, tomorrow they'll get what they deserve. I'll be even stronger than today. Everyone would see who is the real leader here. I'm counting on Hashem. No, Hashem is not a liar, chas v'shalom. If Hashem told me I'm the leader, and he told me to do what I did, and I did exactly what he said, I know I'm okay, right? What chance in the world these wicked people will have to make a revolution and take my place? What chance? What, Hashem is playing games here? The answer, Chazal say, Moshe was afraid because they're all praying tefillah shel rabim, even wicked, reshaim, big reshaim. You saw what was their end. It can turn everything around. So what do we see? That even if Hashem wants something and it's technically guaranteed to happen and somebody is praying, he has the power to change everything around. Otherwise, Moshe wouldn't be bothered, b'chlal, wouldn't be nervous. We'll just go to sleep, relax, enjoy, get up in the morning. Today it's my day. All my enemies are going to be destroyed today. Leman yiru v'yirau. But that's not what happened. Moshe Rabbeinu knew the power of the prayer. On the other hand, it's beautiful to give a speech and to give nice drasha. But in reality, it looks like if a person prays so many times, I don't want to say most of the time, but many times, you feel like you're talking and begging and crying and the situation only gets worse. Moshe Rabbeinu himself said to Hashem, from the minute you sent me to Paro, right, the problem, the situation became worse. Moshe Rabbeinu was arguing with Hashem. You told me everything will be fine, you'll save us. From now, for the time being, the situation only getting worse. So even Moshe Rabbeinu was afraid. The question is, what are the reasons that the davening, the prayers of the person, does not get accepted? What? If Hashem is very anxious to give us, we are His children. You want to give your son. You want to give your daughter. So why would Hashem not listen to someone who prays for years, every day, for years, for something? He doesn't give it to him. Why? Let's go together about all the possible reasons why the prayers sometimes will not be accepted. Rule number one, many people pray for something that it's not good for them. They think it's good. With their understanding, they are convinced that it's good. But Hashem knows that that's going to be their destruction. How many times a person come to me, I met this girl, I went on a date with her, and now she doesn't want me. So I'm praying, I'm crying to Hashem every day already for weeks that she will reconsider. And Hashem doesn't help. What's the answer to that? How do you even know if she's your shiduch b'chlal? Maybe she's going to be your destruction. What are you praying for something you don't know if it's good or not? Soon I'm going to give the answer how we should pray, because most of the people do not pray correctly. And that's why we have a lot of problems in life. Sometimes we come and we mean well and we're causing ourselves more problems. The way we daven, we messed up our life. You're going to understand that soon. So that's an example. We pray for something that is not good for us. Second, mouth that is dirty from Averos now comes to become a sanegor. The mouth that constantly murder people with Lashon Hara, Rechilus, gossip, cursing, Nibul Peh. Chazal say, you learn Torah 70 years, you reach the highest level of holiness, like a Navi almost. Ruach HaKodesh, everything. One moment of anger, you cursed or you say something that is Nibul Peh, you lose the holiness of 70 years of Kedusha. You don't lose, Chas V'Shalom, the learning. Whatever you learn, it's your mitzvah. It goes with you to Olam Haba. But the Kedusha that He created in you, the learning, it's all gone. With one Nibul Peh, 70 years of Kedusha, one time Nibul Peh. Something that is not Sanua or Chas V'Shalom is a bad word. He's losing everything. This is the power of the mouth. Power of the mouth is critical. Most of the people do not understand the power of the mouth. That's why they talk non-stop. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai asked Hashem, why didn't you make two mouths? One for Kedusha, one for Chol. Same mouth is speaking about davening and Torah, and the same mouth is going to speak about business and the weather and whatever happens on the street. How can it be? You couldn't understand how the same mouth is going to say right now, Ashrei Yoshev Betecha Ad Yaluch HaSela, and 2 minutes later he's going to speak to his wife about intimacy. How can it be? And Hashem said to him, one mouth the person cannot control. You want him to have two? I was thinking to myself, if a person would have two mouths, you know what would happen? All day would fight with himself. Why? Because every Jew has, for everything, at least two opinions. Everything you ask him, what's your opinion about this? He already have two opinions ready. First, he wants to hear what you say. Whatever you say, he's going to say the opposite. If you say left, he's going to say right. If you say right, he's going to say left. Why? My son asked me, how come that person that saw you last night in the hallway was asking you these questions? So I said to him, do you really think that the person that was asking me this question really believed what he's saying? Of course not. I know from his body language he doesn't. So why he wasted so much? The people want attention. They want their opinions to be heard. They want to talk. They will find something to initiate a conversation. Doesn't matter they believe, don't believe. It happens all the time. In lectures, right away, you have to detect the person that came to be heard. Not everyone comes to hear. Some people come to get their attention. That's why they ask a lot, they talk a lot, they argue. They like the attention. That's a common thing. So going back to what I started, person that speaks Lashon Hara all day, he murders people every hour. You heard what this guy did, you heard what they say about him on the news, you heard this, he's sending, he's talking. He's commenting about it. Now he comes 5-10 minutes later and stands in front of Hashem with such devotion. Hashem, I have this problem. I need you to save me. Hashem said, look at his mouth. 2 minutes ago, he just murdered a person, destroyed his life. Now he stands in front of me and he wants me to listen to his davening. It's a very big problem. What do you think? Life is a picnic here? You do whatever you want and everything will be forgotten? It doesn't work like that. You want the power of your prayers to be strong? One condition, keep your mouth clean. No nibule pe, no lashon hara, no rechilus, no divrei kfira. How many times people speak kfira? Not always they're aware of it. Sometimes we speak things that is mamash serious. I give you one example. There could be a person that has love to Hashem like you cannot believe. And it's very strong in Shmiras Mitzvot, in davening, in learning Torah. But he comes and he says, the only way that you connect to Hashem is to connect first to someone and he will connect you to Hashem. He doesn't understand that it's 100% Christianity, that it's 100% Natsrut, Kfira, Avodah Zarah. He doesn't understand that Hashem doesn't want middlemen. Everybody goes directly to Hashem. Chas v'shalom, that we need to go to Hashem from someone to connect us, like the Christian made it up. Chas v'shalom. Yes, tzaddikim. Yes, you pray that the zchut of the tzaddik will help you, no problem. Yes, you pray with the tzaddik together in the same minyan. Yeah, of course, all these things is no problem. But to say the only way to connect to Hashem is only if you connect to this rabbi that died, and he's the only one that can connect you, is 100% kfira in avodah zarah. If a person speaks like this, and this is his ideology, how does he expect Hashem to hear him? If he's mekaven his tefillah to connect to that person, that will connect him to Hashem. Something that Hashem cannot stand. You know, the goyim, you know what they do? The goyim, they put a statue of Yoshke. They pray to him. They put it like this on the table. They pray to Yoshke. For them, this is the one that would do everything. They know there is a God who made the world. They're not denying it. They just have shituf. Shituf, it's a big problem. For a Jew, for sure, it's a very big problem. For goyim, machloket if it's avodah zarah or not. But for Jews, no question asked. Avodah zarah 100%. Yes. We'll get to it. We'll get to the Yud Gimel Midot. So, the mouth has to be clean. A person has to keep his mouth clean. What are the other reasons why the prayers are not accepted? Yes, you're right. It's true what you say. But I'm bringing now all the possible conditions why Hashem doesn't listen to a prayer of a person. Now I'll explain to you something. There are people that Rishayim, everything they do is bad. There are people who knows the truth. Who do you think affect the world more? A frum yid that knows who is Hashem and he grew up in yeshiva in an Orthodox community, or Chiloni that was born in Tel Aviv or in a kibbutz and doesn't know anything from his life and all day does averos. The Haredi, he does one or two averos a day, and the Chiloni does 2,000 averos a day. Who do you think make Hashem angrier? Haredi, 100%. If you have two kids, one left the house, chas v'shalom, when he was a kid, grew up like a goy, a bum on the streets with all the criminals, and he comes back after 10 years home when he's now 23, and he mamash like a goy, tattoos, earrings, speaks Hashem Yirachem how he speaks, mamash, you will never know if this kid is a Jew. And then you have a yeshiva bachur, kids, mamash, yirei shamayim. When this other bad kid every 2 minutes does something bad, you already know it's a lost case. What are you gonna do? But you have this one that makes one or two averos a day, kills you.
But you're not going to answer him? That's a difference.
You will. But the idea is that Hashem wants to educate us. You want me to listen to your mouth? Listen to my mouth. I say, don't speak Lashon Hara, don't murder people. I don't say it's the only reason. Many times we speak Lashon Hara and we pray and Hashem does hear us. It's not a solid rule that if you spoke Lashon Hara, that's it. From now on, Hashem doesn't listen to you ever again. But it's something that can ruin the power of the prayers. There's no question about this. Third, kavana. Do you have in mind, or you just come to finish davening? Some people enter the shul not some, many people. And the minute they enter the shul, they begin to think, when will I get out of this burden already? No, when is it going to be over already? Oh my gosh, it's already 9 o'clock. From the minute he came in, he has already negative approach. I have to daven. Do I have a choice? What would I do? I won't show up to the minyan. The Rebbe is going to get angry. My wife is going to tell me why I don't go to shul. You know, he's afraid of other things. He doesn't really come with emunah that I'm coming now to talk to Hashem and he's going to hear me. He's like a robot. Right away, ask people sometimes. I wish there was a machine that you connect to the people's mind when they enter the shul to pray, and you will see on the screen what goes through their minds when they daven. You know what would be? Now one person would show up to shul. Big embarrassment. Why? This is how it goes. Hashem Sfatai Tiftar, Ufi Agiti Latecha. Wow, I have a meeting with Mr. Leibovich at 10. I better not be late. It's my chance to make money. Yeah. Baruch Ata Hashem, Elokeinu Velokei Avotenu. Off my wife again. For God, I have to go pick up the kids. Elokei Avraham, Elokei Yitzchak. Now, wow, today is my lucky day. Then 500 things goes into his mind. Now he asks, why Hashem doesn't listen to my prayers? What prayers? You know what's the biggest joke? When we finish to daven, what's the last word we say? Yihyu leratzon imrefi vehegyon libi lefanecha. You know what it means? I'll tell you what it means. Everything I just say and everything I just thought should be welcome in front of you. You will accept it. I'm not so sure if you want to say it when you finish davening. Because if a person thought about something horrible, how does he say to Hashem, "Yu leratzon imrefi ve'egon libifanecha"? You want your thoughts to go to Hashem to be leratzon? What is it, a sacrifice? Hashem irachem, a person thought about an avera he made a day or two ago. Horrible thing. Yisur karet. Yu leratzon. Accept it with love. Doesn't make sense. That's why we gotta be careful. Better me'at bekavana than arbe that not bekavana. Better you focus on some part of the tefillah, but really with kavanah, than to pray and pray and pray even for hours, but you don't think about what you say. So we have to have kavanah. Otherwise it's me'akev, tefillah. What other reasons that the tefillah cannot be accepted? Sometimes a person is in a situation of midah keneged midah. He got a punishment from Hashem. And that's because of something that he did. So Hashem gave him similar punishment. You hurt someone in one thing, Hashem is hurting you in the same thing. That was already a gzerah, decree. It was made on Rosh Hashanah, based on what you did in the last year. And Hashem already made that decision, and he signed and sealed, and it's a done deal. That's it. Yom Kippur passed, you did not get mechila, now you're praying. Avar zmano, batel korbano. That's it. It's a gzera already. I'll explain to you what it means, gzera. Gzera literally means a decree. But what does it mean, a decree? Decree cannot be canceled? Many times in history, decrees were canceled. Right? I'll give you an example. One person went to a shul, and he saw on a paroches, it's written, Le'ilui nishmat, Shmuel Satan. Shmuel Satan. Do you know a Jew that his last name is Satan? If there was such a thing, for sure he would change it, no? He would make it Steinberg. He wouldn't keep it Satan, no? So I want to ask you a question. How is it possible that in a shul they put in a paroches to the memory, Le'ilui Nishmat, Shmuel Satan? So he came to the gabbai. He said to him, what's going on over here? Ooh, what Jid? His name was Shmuel Satan. Say, oh, you don't know the story? Let me tell you the story. What was the story? One Jew was a very big tzaddik. His name was Shmuel Alevi. He was a Levi. One day he walked on the street and he found a wallet. He opened the wallet and he saw that the wallet belongs to the prince, the son of the king. He went to the palace. There were soldiers standing over there. So I came to return a lost object to the prince. They say, give it to us, we'll give it to him. Say, no, I'm sorry. I must give it to him in his hand. If you want, he can come down, or if you let me go up, I'll give it to him. They went, they asked, said, okay, let him in. The king and the prince were just in a meeting. He came in, and he gave them the wallet. The king said to his son, check that all the cash is there. The prince was counting the money, and he saw everything is there to the last penny. So he said to his father, it's all here. The king said to the Jew, what would you like in return for giving us the wallet back? You could have got the cash. Very nice of you that you returned it. What can I do for you? The Jew said, nothing. I didn't come to get something from you. I came to give you what's yours. We, the Jews, have a mitzvah. We return lost objects. We don't take it. The king say, it's very nice of you. I appreciate you now even more, but it's an insult for me that someone did such a favor to me and I let him go empty-handed. Tell me what I can do for you. You need any favor? You have a problem? Something? He said to him, no. I really don't want anything from you. I just came to give it to you and that's it, to leave. So the king said, listen. I got you. Let me give you a card with my signature. Get out of jail free. If one day you're going to have a problem and you really need something, you always come to me and show me this card, remind me what you did for us. We owe you a favor. Fair? The Jews say fair. He signed and he gave it to him. Few months later, this country went into a war. They had a war, and now the king is running out of cash. They need money. So they say, the advisor, the Jews, they make a lot of money. Increase the tax to 80% until the war will be over. 80% instead of 30%. The king say, good idea, and he signed the bill. The Jews saw, wow, 80% tax. Who wants to go to work, Bichlal? 80% tax. Better stay home. Everyone was upset. Everyone is depressed. Then one person say, Rabbi Shmuel Alevi, the king owe him a favor. He's the only one who can get right away into the king and cancel the decree. They came to him, said, no, I don't want to get anything for that mitzvah. They said, listen, it's pikuach nefesh now. Everyone here will work for nothing. You gotta go and speak to the king. The rabbi say, he listened. He went to the king. It was 4 p.m. The king was about to leave. That's it. 4 o'clock, he goes to sleep. So now they're on the way to close the doors. And they said to the people, whoever needs to speak to the king, come back next week. But there's no time for next week. They said to him, it's an emergency. Please show the king the card. The king saw the card, he remembered the Jew from a few months ago. So the king was on the way out, was putting his coat. He said to the Jew, I know I owe you a favor, but you're going to have to come next Wednesday. Because I'm leaving, I have one minute, I got to go. So the Jew said, I'm sorry, it's an emergency. So the king told him, can you tell me your problem in 4 words? If yes, talk. If not, come back next week. So the Jew said, yes. He said, okay, go ahead. He said, Vayomer Hashem el Satan. So he said to him, what did he say to the Satan? He said, 4 words. He said, okay, come. Tell me the story. He got him curious. So he told him the whole Haftarah with Hashem, Vigarba Satan. And somehow he got into the problem. So the king said, you're very clever. You got my attention, and I owe you a favor. I'm willing to cancel the tax in one condition. Since you fooled me with the Satan, from now on your name will be Satan. If I hear one Jew calling you Levi, right away I put the tax back and I owe you nothing. And believe me, I'm going to put spies. You agree? You say, I agree. Your name is from now on Shmuel Satan. Remember this. Everywhere. I say, yes, I agree. You can go. The tax is canceled. He came back. They made a Veida. All the people came. Rabotai, if you care about your money, from now on, forget that he's a Levi. From now on, everyone call him Shmuel Satan. And of course, the Jews don't want to lose their money. No one forgot. when it comes to the packet, people remember very well. So after years, no one even remembered that his name was Levi. That's it, Shmuel Satan, 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 Rabbi Satan, Shmuel Satan. When he died, they forgot, they wrote, Leilui Nishmat, Shmuel Satan. On a parochet, decrees can be canceled. So why Hashem doesn't cancel the decrees? I'll tell you why. If a person, Chas V'Shalom, starting to have pain, he's dizzy, he checks what's the symptoms, and he see over there, it's possibly cancer. Not every pain is cancer, obviously, but there's a chance to be cancer. Right away, his heart's dropping, and he's getting very nervous. Oh my God, no, I'm too young for it. Come on, it cannot be cancer now. Come on, I have plans. So now he has to go to the doctor to have an MRI or whatever they do, CAT scan, whatever. So he goes to the doctor. The doctor send him to x-rays and all of that, and they see a growth. Lo aleinu. They found it over there. Now they take it and they send it to the lab. They say in 1 week you're going to get an answer. 1 week later, the answer come, lo aleinu, positive. Now, when he found out he has cancer, he's starting to send messages, emails. He comes to rabbis, to all the people, to the children, everyone to pray for him because he has an operation in 3 months, 2 months, to remove it. Maybe he'll succeed, maybe he'll die. We don't know. This is what happened usually. Once the news came out, that means there's a decree that Hashem sent him this sickness, lo aleinu. Once it came out to the world, it's a million times harder to fix it than before it came out to the world. Let me explain. When he had the pain, the first thing he should have done is to pray right away with tears to Hashem. In case, chas v'shalom, it's something serious, please take it out now, before I even get to the doctor. That's step number one. Even after he went to the doctor, it's still not too late, because the doctor himself doesn't know what it is. He has to send him to a specialist. So the doctor, after examining him, now he went one step higher, because now the doctor confirmed that there is a chance it's cancer. So now it's a little bit less productive than before, because now there is a chance. But still, it's not news yet. No one knows about it yet. Now he goes to the x-ray, they do all the x-rays. 1 week, they're going to get the answer. This week, the news did not come out yet. It could be cancer right now. It doesn't know. No one knows yet. Only Hashem knows. If now he does tshuva, and people pray, and he pray, and he gives his heart into it, Hashem can accept his prayer and remove it from his body, even though it's reality already. That's it. It was decreed on Rosh Hashanah, and he got it after Yom Kippur, and it started in a body. Nobody knows about it besides Hashem. Since no one knows about it, no one in the world, if Hashem accepted his prayers, he removes it from his body without anyone knowing. He will only find out when he died that Hashem saved him from death because of his prayers. However, once the news came out, and everybody knows he has it, and now he's having a challenge to fight for his life, to remove it now, it's going to be a clear miracle. If you are Avraham Avinu, Hashem did clear miracle for Avraham Avinu. Ordinary people, what are the chances that Hashem will change nature for them to remove it like it's gone, like it was not there? Very, very small. Now you need tefillat harabim, thousands of people. It's a million times harder than before. Not literally a million, but you understand the point. Much harder. Why? Because it already became official. Everyone knows about it. If all of a sudden he's going to come and say, guess what? I prayer and all of you prayer and the cancer disappeared from my body. The doctors don't understand. It happens, by the way. I see from time to time miracles like this. But now it's much, much harder. You need zchuyot for it. Before, it was not a clear miracle because no one knows about it. No one knows that Hashem changed nature for you. Therefore, it doesn't cancel the Bechira. Remember, clear miracles hurting the Bechira. If people see that Hashem does clear miracles, what happened to them? Of course, who wouldn't want to be a tzaddik? That's the way it works. So here is another example why sometimes you may pray, but it's a little bit too late. Why the decree was made, and the news became news, and now it's much, much harder to cancel it. You need a lot of zchuyot. You need a lot of tzedakah. One more reason why the prayers are not accepted, it's the shul and the minyan that you're praying in. Talking now for the men. You may come to a place that the whole building is from stolen money. There's a lot of foreign people that steal tons of money from the government. Insurance fraud, Medicaid fraud, all kinds of things like that. People will have beautiful beards and nice sombreros. All day they steal. And now, to relax their conscience, they give few million dollars to the community. And they build a synagogue, all with stolen money from the children of Esav. And all the zchuyot of this shul go to the Sitra Achra. Doesn't go to Hashem, goes to the Sitra Achra. Why? Hashem, chotamo shel Hashem emet. Hashem is not a cooperator of crooks and liars and thieves. If the whole place is built with such money, there's no bracha in this place. If Hashem likes you, He will do something that you won't be able to come to that place. Someone will ask you to be mashlim minyan somewhere else to save you from that place. Or it could be a place that people speak in the middle of davening all the time. Disrespect the shul. There's no respect over there. Or it's a place that the women come there, Hashem Yerachem, with no tznius. And the rabbi over there is a puppet, is afraid to talk because he's afraid that the rich board will fire him. That's usually what happens in most of the shuls, that rabbis are only a picture on a wall. They're afraid to talk. If they speak about Chilul Shabbos, they threaten them. Why are we talking about people that come with a car? We want them to come. It's income for the shul. Yeah, but it's not allowed to drive the car on Shabbos. Rabbi, do me a favor, don't be fanatic. It's our problem, not yours. We paid for the place, we need income. Let everyone come. He's afraid. I put pressure on him. Now you may come and say, what kind of rabbi he is? Well, he's not a man of the truth. He should stand and speak anyway. Fire him, fire him. It's not so simple. Why? Then rabbis would be fired every week. But every week he's going to move with his children to a new community. They just settled in yeshiva, now he has to move. Okay, no, take the kids out, put them in a new place. 2-3 weeks later, he speaks about tznius. The president get angry. Why? His wife is not tzanua. He looked at that as a direct attack. He fires him again. Now he has to move again to another, until he find a job, until he find a community. It's never going to end. He's thinking, better I be here than someone worse than me. At least I'm afraid to talk, but I teach a little Torah. They're going to bring somebody conservative, it's going to be a lot worse. And he stayed there 20 years, and the place stayed the same, and Hashem is angry. This place is mamash Sodom and Gomorrah. I've seen things you never believe. Baruch Hashem, by Hasidim, you don't see these things. Baruch Hashem. What do I see? Did you ever see that you go to a synagogue on Shabbat, and you have hundreds of people, and many of them come with cars and they park right in front of the shul with no shame, and they take their phone, iPhone, and take picture because there's a bar mitzvah to their nephew, the women upstairs in Ezrat Nashim on Shabbat. Candy, and they take pictures in front of the Sefer Torah. Do you ever see such thing? I asked the rabbi, how do you allow it? What are you going to do? You're not going to let them do bar mitzvah? Chilonim. Yeah, you're not going to let them do bar mitzvah. Who needs bar mitzvah bichlal? What's bar mitzvah? Is the oraita? It's not even the rabbanan. Rav Shach bar mitzvah was, he got tefillin from his mother. That's it. He put the tefillin. Rav Chaim Kanievsky bar mitzvah was, cookies and a schnapp. That's it. That was the bar mitzvah. What's bar mitzvah? Bar mitzvah is to keep mitzvot. You're not keeping mitzvot, what are you making bar mitzvah bichlal? Stupidity. You're announcing that you became a man and accept mitzvot and you mechalel Shabbos? Bar mitzvah. Don't let them in. Ah, the shul needs money. You understand what's happening here? If you pray in a place like this, the chance that your prayers is accepted is much, much lower. And there's no games here with Hashem. There's no games. By Hashem, it's all precise. So that's why many of the things that we do, we wonder why Hashem doesn't accept it. Sometimes is what time you davening. What time you daven? 11 o'clock you daven, you're not ashamed? It's already almost mincha. Zrizim makdimim la mitzvot. Why are you not in a shul 6, 7? Why it's 11? 11 o'clock is wasting so much time from the time you get up until it begins to daven. It's also a problem. There could be many, many things. Women, when women pray, sometimes it's the way they dress. Many religious women are not modest. Many. What does it mean, not modest? They have wigs that are very, very long. It's not tzanua. No one allowed this kind of wigs. For those poskim who allowed wigs, you're not going to find one that allowed the wigs that women wear today in our communities. It has to be short and modest, not attracting too much attention. For those who allow it, some poskim are totally against it. Rav Vosner was Hasidish, to the best of my knowledge, spoke very, very strong against wigs. He did not allow it at all. Rav Ovadia Yosef was very much against it. There are many, many holy people who are against it. But we have to know the rules. The rules are that every time you have Gadol Batorah, somebody big in Torah, that allows something, you cannot say that this someone who does it, it's an Avera. Why? There's somebody Gadol allows it. He knows Torah just as much as the other one who forbid that. So to make fun and to say, oh, Rashaim, how they do it, that's a very common big mistake that people do. Why are you criticizing it? Rav Moshe Feinstein Zatzal allowed it. What do you think, is a clown? What do you think he was? He knew the whole Torah, just as much as the other posek. Shivim panim la Torah. He can find a way to be matir. He can find a way to be osir. But everyone agree that the kind of wigs that most women wear today, no one allowed. I always say to women, I'm not telling you not to wear wig because I know there's big rabbis that allow it. But I'm asking you a question. When you come to Shamayim, and you stand in front of Hashem, and Hashem will ask you, why did you wear a wig? You're going to say, I was counting of Rav Moshe Feinstein. I was counting of the Lubavitch Rebbe. You're going to have what to say, no? Then they're going to call him, say, Lubavitch Rebbe, please come here. Did you allow the wig like this? Chas v'shalom. It's not Sanua. Rav Moshe Feinstein, please come, Kvodo. Did you allow such a wig? Chas v'shalom. But if it's Sanua, he will put his head down and say, yes, I allowed. It's in my book. It's in my drashas. I allowed the wig. But this is the wig I was talking about. Not this, like this, that she walks and she sweeps the floor with that. No, that's not what I meant. I know it's hard for the ladies, but life is not a picnic. Adam la'amal yulad. It's also hard to learn Gemara all day. Who say life is easy? You want to get a schar? You have to sweat for it. Much of the clothes that they wear today, it's all attached to the body. Hasidish woman even. Even Hasidish woman. It's not tzanua. It's against the halacha. Now one day in her life she's tzanua. Some ladies, mostly from the previous generation, they wear white, everything, Baruch Hashem, 100%. But the new generation, everything is tight, the skirt is short, barely below the knees. When they sit, it goes above the knees. They have high heels like this, like the Twin Towers. You know? And then they think, why Hashem doesn't listen to me that my kid is off the derech? You yourself are off the derech. What do you worry about him? Your situation is much worse. At least he's not machtia rabim. You're machtia tarabim. You walk in the street, 1,000 people look at you. Every day, 1,000 sins goes to your account. Every day. You worry about him? The poor kid, maybe he was molested, maybe he was abused. Who knows what happened to his mind? He may be bichlal anus. Some of the off-the-derech kids, they won't even be punished. They become mechalelei Shabbos, they eat treif. When they die, Hashem will send them right back in Gilgul. It's not your fault. It's this person's fault, it's that person's fault, it's the uncle's fault, it's the Rebbe's fault. You know, I tell you something. You know, Rav Shlomo Zalman Oirbach, Zecher Tzadik Vekadosh Livracha, was a very big posek and tzadik. In a bar mitzvah of his son, he made a bracha, Baruch Atah Hashem, אלוקינו מלך העולם, שפטרני מעונשו של זה. And he said the name of Hashem, Shem ומלכות. Everyone in a hall were shocked. Since when you say the name of Hashem? When you don't say that. You say Baruch שפטרני מעונשו של זה. That's it. You don't say the name of Hashem. Chazal say in Gemara, every bracha that doesn't have the name of Hashem in it, it's not a bracha. What is it? Stop saying words. It's not considered a bracha. So why we don't really say the name of Hashem in a bracha? Why? The answer, when Rav Shlomo Zalman Auerbach said the name of Hashem, everyone ran to him, all the rabbis. Rabbi, how come? And he gave a drasha. This was his drasha. Listen to this. He said, are you allowed to say a bracha on Eli? Baruch ata Hashem, Elokeinu melech haolam, asher kidishanu mitzvotav etzivanu leechol chazir. Can you say such a bracha when you eat chazir? You're going to get a bigger punishment for the bracha than the actual eating, for the chutzpah. Right or wrong? Clear, no? Okay. You cannot say bracha for Eli. So Rav Shlomo Zalman Auerbach said, how can you stand in front of Hashem when your son is 13 and make a bracha with the name of Hashem, that Hashem is releasing you from responsibility and from the punishment of this boy? It's baloney. You're going to pay for the sins of this boy until the day you die. Because it's all your fault. You did not raise him correctly. What are you coming and standing in front of the audience and say, Baruch ata Hashem Elokeinu melech haolam sheptarani me'onsho shel zeh. Hu ptaranu. Hashem did not poter you. It's your fault that he makes averot. It's your fault he speaks lashon hara. It's your fault he doesn't daven on time. It's all your fault. He learned from you. So therefore, since we are far from being perfect, we cannot say the name of Hashem. But I, Rav Shlomo Zalman Auerbach, I know I didn't make one mistake raising this boy. Everything I did exactly like Hashem wanted. I know I did not make one mistake. Everything I taught him exactly the way it should be. So I know it's not bracha levatala. It's not a lie. You understand this? This is what he says in the drash of his son's bar mitzvah. And one more thing he says when his wife was niftar. Everybody knows that, I'm sure. It's good for the video. He said to his wife, now it's the time to ask you for mechila. That's what the minag is before your wife goes away. You bury her, lo alenu. You have to ask her for mechila. But you and me knows that I don't have one reason to ask you for mechila and you don't have any reason to ask me for mechila. We never had one fight. We never had one problem between us. Everything was perfect. I will ask mechila anyway, but you and me knows we don't really need. How many people can say it in one day? Forget 7 years of marriage. One day. By the end of the day, when you say Kriyat Shema on Emita, Areni Mochel Vesoleach, that you say to your wife, today I have no reason to be Mochel you for anything. Or she say to you, Gershon, today was perfect day. Not one thing you did that didn't get me angry. Even 1 hour sometimes. But this is us, and this is them. So going back to what I said, there are many reasons that the davening is put on hold. Sometimes a person is asking for something that right now is not good for him, but it will be good for him in 3 years. As we said in the tefillah, ואתה נותן להם את אוכלם בעיתו. Hashem says, I can give it to you now, but now it's not going to be a benefit. You will need it in three years from now when your son gets married. I'm holding it for your own good. Don't give up. Sometimes you're a very big tzaddik and Hashem enjoy your davening. There's also a concept like this. Why all the mothers were barren? Because Hashem mitavel et filatam shel tzaddikim. Abraham pray, Yaakov pray, everyone pray because their wife don't have kids. Hashem enjoy the davening of the righteous people. But the righteous people in the meantime suffer. Don't worry. Suffering has a price. Every day you suffer, it will make your olam haba better. When you see the reward you're going to get for every day of suffering, you will scream to Hashem, why did you not give me enough suffering?
So just created
to go away. Oh, the Chazal said that. Chazal said, lo yisurim velo scharam. Don't give me the suffering and don't give me the reward. Why? Because the nature of a person, when he suffers, chas v'shalom, he can be kicking and breaking. We don't want to take that risk. But if it already happened, grab as much as you can. One Jew, he was walking in the forest, and one Cossack guy came with a stick and started to hit him, beating him up brutally. Then the Jew got lucky. The king with few soldiers were passing by on horses. The king said to him, hey, stop. Why are you beating him up? So he said to him, what do you care? He's a Jew. So the king said, oh, he's a Jew? What do you think? Everyone can do whatever they want here. Arrest him. They got him to the prison in a palace over there. They took the Jew to the palace. The doctor of the king took care of him for a few days. After a few days, the king made a trial. He asked the goy, how many times you hit him with a stick? The goy didn't know how long the king was there. Maybe he was watching all alone. He was afraid to lie. So approximately 100 times. So the king said to the Jew, is that right? The Jew said, yes, I believe it's about 100 times. So he said to him, for every time you hit him, you give him 1,000 ruble. 100,000 ruble by tomorrow. If not, we hang you. The goy said, okay, I'm going to get the money. What can I do? The Jew started to cry. So he asked the king asked the Jew, why? I'm not a fair judge? We didn't make justice here? He said, no, your honor, your majesty. Of course you're a fair judge. That's not what I'm crying. He said, why? He said, while he was beating me up, I was holding the stick and fighting him back. If I knew every time he smacked me, it's 1,000 ruble, I would say, faster. Go ahead. Why are you so slow? This is the story of our life. This, Mashal. That's the story of our life, yes.
What do you respond to a child, and how do you explain it to a child that, let's say, went off and he says, I always daven for Hashem to get me out of the situation?
First of all, what does it mean to get me out of the situation? Maybe that's the test that Hashem wants you to go. Hashem puts a person in a test and he wants to get out of the situation. What's the point? The whole reason that I put you in this world is to get into this situation. There's a lot of nision, not right?
It's an evil situation?
Evil. Every hard situation, it's evil in a way. Mm-hmm. If a person comes to the world with a sickness, he was born with a sickness. I just now was in L.A. last Shabbat, and they took me on Friday to visit a baby, a few months old. He was born with a big hole in his heart. The organs are in the opposite side. You know how many surgeries they need to keep him alive and to keep him functioning? Did you even know that some babies are born with organs in the other side? The heart goes in the right side. The kidneys are switching one here, one up, one down, all kinds of strange things in the body. It happens once in a while. So now, the father and the mother are young people over there. Young, mamash young. I don't think they're even 30. So the mother showed up. First we went with the father, and I think half an hour later, the mother showed up, alive. Not depressed. I said to her, Bezrat Hashem, everything will work out. We pray for him. She said, no, it's all from Hashem. It's strong emunah. They have this situation, the parents. They got it from Hashem. The baby got it from Hashem. Now, if you say, Hashem, I don't want this nisayon. I don't want it. Hashem says, okay, I'll take away the nisayon. But that's the way, that's your way to make the schar for Olam Haba. This is why I send you to the world. This is your tikkun. I want to tell you something. You know, a few, like 2-3 years ago when I spoke about the autistic kids, everyone went crazy. The reason they went crazy because they are ignorant. They don't know what it is. If they knew, they wouldn't make a beep. Many times people are sent to the world with some kind of a defect which is decided by Hashem based on the sins that we did in our previous life. Some person comes without legs, or the legs cannot function, or all kinds of things like this. It's very difficult for parents to hear that maybe his kid is someone who made sins in a previous life. It's very difficult for someone that his kid is brain damaged or something like this, and hear a speaker say that that's because of something he did in his previous life. It's emotionally, it's hard. But people that knows the way reincarnations work, and they read the Ari HaKadosh, then they know Hashem doesn't do anything for no reason. Hashem doesn't, is not a sadist that sits and enjoys making people suffer. So everything we came to the world with, there's a reason for it. What is the reason that autistic kids, first of all, they die young, they don't live such long life, they die younger, many of them are mute, they cannot function, they cannot talk, and they found a way over 20 years ago that they can communicate with them through computers. And I put a video on my Facebook page of unbelievable thing. An Israeli autistic kid, we'll finish with that because we have 1 minute, that was born with a twin sister. The sister is normal, and the boy, something went wrong, and he became autistic. As they came with a computer and they filmed it on a video, thank God they filmed it live, they asked the kid, why are you like this? Why you came to the world like this? And he said, because of mistakes that I made in my previous life, this is my tikkun. He's typing. You can see mamash the video, how on the screen he's typing. So they say to him, what mistakes you did in your previous life? He say, I spoke things that I'm not supposed to. And Hashem sent me to this world like this for my tikkun. And they continue. And all his family were not religious, secular family. So they ask him, what things you spoke? He say, I spoke Lashon Hara about people. Lashon Hara, gossip. And this is my tikkun. In your eyes, you see. Why I came to the world like this? Because of what I did in my previous life. Why he came like this and other people that spoke Lashon Hara did not come back like this? Hashem has his calculation. Everyone has his tikkunim. Sometimes it's not only one tikkun. You should know that when you see autistic kids, the Chazon Ish was standing for them. Because that means that it's very, very righteous people that has only a little bit to fix. We are in a much worse situation. I went 18 years ago to speak to autistic kids in Borough Park. I think his father was Rav Lifshitz or Rav Horvitz in Borough Park. His father is a Talmid Chacham, has thousands of books in the house. And the boy back then was 12. He should be 30 today if he's still alive. And I told him, I feel very bad for you. Because he said, I suffer 1,000 tortures a minute. He was typing. 1,000 tortures a minute. I didn't understand what it means, 1,000 tortures a minute. So out of sympathy, I said to him, I feel very bad for you. So you know what he answered me? Don't feel bad for me. Feel bad for yourself. I say, why? He say, because I am very close to my tikkun already. I have very little to fix and I go to my place in heaven. You people have much more to fix until you get there. Although I suffer, I'm already there almost. I'm almost there. You have a long way to go. Bezrat Hashem will be matzliach. I didn't finish what I wanted to say because it's a short session. But if you want to go to my website, divineinformation.com, I have a whole lecture about davening, prayers, the power of the prayers. I explain every bracha from where it came, from which Navi, from this, from Chazal, from Tehillim, what's behind each bracha in a Tfilat Shmona Esre. Bezrat Hashem, you can see. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen v'amen.